Well, greetings. My name is Peter Hay, and I'm standing here in the sanctuary of the United Methodist Congregation that gathers for worship and for mission in Wilmington, Massachusetts, and I bid you welcome for this weekend worship video for the second Sunday in Lent in the year 23. And it is a delightful day in our congregation because we're observing a 30-hour famine, which is a program that helps us understand the dynamics of world hunger and mobilizes us to solve some of these very important global problems. And as we celebrate, you'll see the sanctuary is appropriately adorned, and we have some of our young people participating in parts of our service for this video and on Sunday morning. So I bid you welcome. And as we begin our time together, I invite us to be called to worship.
Open minds awake, change us now for heaven's sake. Leave us not alone in hatred's wake. Show us how to love. Show us how to love. Show us how. Show us how to love.
Oftentimes we believe that we must deserve the love we receive. We work, work, work to get approval and to feel like our lives are justified, pulling our own weight, thinking that whatever life we create and love we get is only what we ourselves can conjure up. But the scriptures today offer a message of God as our keeper, always helping, always present. Nicodemus has followed all the rules and done everything he can do, and yet he's still looking for love, for tangible connection with God. Jesus says that he must be born of the Spirit. It's not all up to simply doing the right thing. It's about following the Spirit to help birth love in our lives.
Eyes open, shocked awake, much to learn from our mistakes. Draw us closer in our heartache. Show us how to love. Show us how to love. Show us how. Show us how to love. Let us join in to our confession and words of assurance. It is responsive, and your responses will be on the screen. Let us join together in opening our hearts to the love of God. Before we even utter a word, we can be assured God will offer us grace and a way forward. For this reason, we can be honest with what pains us most about our own thoughts and actions. Let us pray. Holy and merciful One, in this season of discernment, we become bringing our deepest longings and our failed attempts at satisfying them. We've often looked for love, for acceptance and security in formulas that will assure success at the expense of staying tuned to the Spirit's nudge. We yearn for lives that matter. We desire relationships that thrive. We want less regret. At times, we fail to see that you already have given us what really matters, your love and acceptance. You provide opportunities all around us to make a difference in the lives of others. You give us a fresh start each day, inviting us to do better. In this silence, we bring to you our pleas for openness to a different way of living. My friends, be assured by the psalmist who says, "The Lord will keep your life, your going out, and your coming in from this time on and forevermore." Let us respond together. We open our hearts, our minds, our souls, our vision to the ways of love created by God, embodied in Jesus, and already moving in us by the Spirit. We are forgiven, loved, and freed. Amen.
Sometimes in our lives, we are the pain, we are the sorrow. But if we are wise, we know the best, always tomorrow.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm out of need. Somebody to lean on.
If there is a load you have to bear that you can carry, I'm right up the road. I'll share your load if you just call me.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for here
somebody to lean on.
You just might have a problem that you'd understand.
We all need somebody to lean on.
Lean on me
when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm on a need.
This is a reading from Psalm 121, Assurance of God's Protection, a Song of Ascents. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither sleep nor slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore.
Second scripture reading, John 3:1-17. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, very truthfully, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from and or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can this be? These things be?
You are the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things. Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive your testimony. If I had told you about early things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did send the Son into the world to commend the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Well, my tradition in this time is to introduce it as the time for our young and for the young at heart. And I think on this Famine Sunday, that statement, that claim has never been more true than today. Because we, as we come together to celebrate a 30-hour famine, it's an old tradition in this church that has seen much progress, and a lot of familiar faces that maybe we haven't seen in a while are coming out. And so this year, we are engaging. The statistics tell us that 6,400 people worldwide die each day from famine, from hunger, and hunger-related disease. And so to acknowledge that and work toward that cause, and to work toward the youngest of the young people, we've been raising diapers. And so I believe we've had a couple opportunities that you may have seen. Our altar at the front of the sanctuary is now a mound of diapers. I believe we are right at, if not just a little over, the goal of 64 packages of diapers, representing 6,400 deaths each day. But we've also seen young people of all ages, the young at heart, have come out to help. And this program has been running in our church for long enough that now I believe we have some children of people that, I don't know if we have children of people who began in famine, but it's been running. And the numbers that I have here say that when we first began, that number is 6,400. It's a startling number. It's a sad number, but it is so far down. When we first began, the number that they told us was 15,000 deaths per day from hunger and hunger-related diseases. And so on this Famine Sunday, we gather here with our young people. We have opportunities for children. We have opportunities for youth, especially, is the focus. We're raising, for the youngest people, diapers, but we also love the support and the generosity of everyone in this community. It has been all hands on deck sort of thing, whether you're donating time or donating diapers or a kind word or donating money to support our youth and their fundraising. It has been a wonderful time. We had a large group here doing all these wonderful decorations. And so if you happen to be watching this before Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, I would encourage you, if you're at all able, to come join us for a wonderful worship service, gathering together with the young and the young at heart. Whether you fasted or experienced a famine in the past, it's a wonderful time. I hope you'll join us.
You are holy, Prince of Peace.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
You're the Lord of Lords, you're the King of Kings, you're the mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel, you're the great I Am, you're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. You're my saving God, you're the saving grace, you will reign forever, the Ancient of Days. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end, you're my Savior.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will live.
Well, Nicodemus comes to Jesus during the night. Most think it's because Nicodemus does not want to be seen with Jesus. Nicodemus is a religious leader during his day, and he has a reputation to protect. You see, Jesus is a controversial religious figure whose teachings challenge the established views. Others wonder if maybe Nicodemus doesn't come at night because Nicodemus is in something of a spiritual darkness. His darkness is that he just doesn't quite understand what it means to be born from above. And just in case some of us in the hearing of this sermon are in the dark about its meaning, I'll venture an explanation. Quite literally, the Greek word in this text is anothen. You must be born anothen. It means from above, from heaven. It could mean from the beginning or the place of origin, to be born from of old. And it could mean being born again or born anew. And then follows this awkward conversation where Nicodemus can't quite seem to grasp the explanations that Jesus gives. Now, who can say if his lack of understanding is an honest expression of difficulty grasping a complex truth, or maybe it's a willful decision to close his mind to an ever-expanding reality of God's love and God's grace. I really can't speak for Nicodemus. I can only speak for myself. And we're never quite sure if Nicodemus comes to understand all of the help that God is willing to offer. Being born from above, being born again, is a metaphor. And metaphors are something like jokes. Either you get them or you don't. What Jesus is trying to say, if I could say in non-metaphoric language, is that the kingdom of God is all around you, but you have to choose to be aware of it, to see it, and to embrace it. The spiritual life is becoming so aware of who God is and what God wants that all of our life goals are altered because of this amazing reality. Well, if you haven't seen this video on YouTube, it's too late because I'm about to ruin it for you. The video starts out and there are 10 people lined up, 5 of whom are wearing white shirts and 5 of whom are wearing black shirts. And each group has a basketball in their hands. And the narrator says, "Can you count how many passes the people in the white shirts make?" And then it begins. In a very complicated, choreographed way, these 10 people begin to move very, very quickly around in circles. And I diligently counted the number of passes that the people in the white shirts tossed to the other. Well, when it got all done, the narrator said, "Did you count? Did you get it right?" There were 13 passes. And I had gotten it right, and I was feeling pretty proud of myself. And then the narrator said, "But did you see the dancing bear?" Well, I hadn't. And sure enough, he shows the video a second time, and while all these 10 people are gyrating and passing and moving, this person dressed up like a bear dances right across the screen. But I never saw it because my eyes were focused on the white shirts and the passing of the ball. To be born from above. To be born again is to see the world very differently than we have been told to look at it. To see what God is doing, and then to give ourselves to that wonder. It is our hope and it is our prayer that as we move through this famine experience, that our eyes become open to things we wouldn't see if we keep focusing where we've been told to focus. So I'm eager. I'm eager as we enter into this experience to see how the hurting people of the world are in need of my help. And I'm eager to learn how I can help other people take care of themselves. I'm eager to grow in the godly joy that comes from mobilizing and from foreseeing myself as a caring person, interconnected with caring people all over the world, to love as God loves. And most of all, I'm eager to see how God can come to me just as Jesus came to Nicodemus. And retrain my eyes to see the deeper spiritual truths. And I'm eager to live a much more fulfilled Christian life. Amen. Well, I do want to continue to express on behalf of the entire congregation gratitude for your faithfulness. Many have gone to the church's website and have followed the prompts for online giving. Others have gone to their own bank and have made arrangements for their gifts to be sent to the church. And still others write checks and drop them off or mail them in. But however you choose to give, I want you to know that your gifts matter, that your generosity enables the church to be faithful to its mission and to its ministry. As we move to our prayer time, I think it's important for you to know that we don't share joys and concerns during this weekend worship video for privacy's sake. But if there's a way that we can pray for you, we hope you'd reach out and let us know. Give us a phone call, send us an email, send us a message through Facebook. If we could pray for you, we would count that as a privilege. So thank you. I invite us now to move to our morning prayers as we'll be led by Jameson and by one of our lay leaders, Ginny.
In this season of Lent, we are joining together in prayer using an ancient form in the church. The Greek words Kyrie eleison mean God have mercy on us. And we learned a simple chant last week that we will be repeating throughout Lent. We will be led in various intercessions, prayers in categories, followed by our sung Kyrie response to each one. The repetition of this beautiful Kyrie is itself a prayer. God's mercy is a gift of love given freely to us.
Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Let us pray for the world. Loving Creator, we come to you asking for the strength of your help in this world. We struggle as we find so much to be chaotic and overwhelming. You set this world in motion and gave us the ability to co-create the future with you. Help us trust your presence in the midst of all we do not understand. Show us how to love, especially when it is not within our control. We pray this day for those torn by war and conflict, division, and we remember those who are hungry. Lord, have mercy. In this singing, we lift up this world to you with our love.
Lord, have mercy, Christ. Upon us, Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy, Lord, have mercy upon us.
Let us pray for our community. Loving Sovereign, we come to you asking for the strength of your help in our communities. We do not see things from the same perspective, and it is causing divisions among us. Show us how to love across these divides of how things ought to be. So many are ailing from circumstances of body, mind, and spirit beyond their control. We pray this day for all on our prayer list, for all who are in need, and for those who have food insecurities within our community. God, have mercy. In this singing, we lift up this community to you with our love.
Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray for our relationships. Loving parent, we come to you asking for the strength of your help in our homes and relationships. Open us to feel the bond of your spirit between us and among us, especially when we are not sure how to help each other. We pause in silence as we each lift up in our hearts the relationships in our lives that need your love and transformation. God have mercy. In this singing, we lift up each other to you with our love.
Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy upon us, Lord have mercy, Christ.
And let us pray for ourselves. Lover of our souls, we come to you asking for the strength of your help to love ourselves. Help us to break out of the prisons we have made for ourselves, believing that we have to work our way into love and acceptance. Help us really know deep down in our bones that it is your already present and ever-present love that is the bedrock of our lives, and that this love can be multiplied through us in this world, in our communities, and in the lives with whom we intersect each day. God have mercy. In this singing, we open ourselves to your love.
Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy upon us, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy upon us.
And as Christ taught us, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
There are two things I would like to lift up as by way of announcement as a part of this video. The first is that, as Jameson has already said so many wonderful things about 30-hour famine, and we are delighted to be sharing in that again this weekend, and if you'd like to be a part of it, please do. The second thing I'd remind you is that each Wednesday evening through the season of Lent, we have a program called Soup and Spirit. We have about an hour together where we share in a light meal of some wonderful soups, and then we devote ourselves to a spiritual practice for strengthening and deepening our faith. So we'd love to have you join us, and each session is not interdependent on the other, so if you don't make all four of them, you will still be spiritually blessed by the ones that you are able to attend. I'd also like to share that on this, since this is the first Sunday of the month, we'll be offering Holy Communion during the morning service. If for any reason you're not comfortable yet returning to in-person worship and desire to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion, I would be pleased to talk with you and arrange for a time for you to receive that sacrament in a way that's comfortable and safe for you. So please call the office and let me know. And now I invite us to end our time together by sharing in a final blessing for the day. Go forth and into the world, looking for love in all of the right places. We look for signs of the Helper, knowing that God is ever present, urging our choice for love.